Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. I received a question in the group where a brother sent it about wiping over the neck in the wudu and raising the hands in a salat. His question is, I would like to clarify something about wudu and the raising of hands during the salat. I noticed people are performing wudu in different ways. Some do wipe the back of the neck while others do not. And then he goes that wiping the neck is a weak hadith. And then he goes and gives some explanation about why it is weak. And then he said the correct method is to wipe from front to back to the nape of the neck, then to front and wiping of neck with the back of hands. What he says is you start from the head from the beginning and you go all the way back to the bottom of your neck and then you go back again to the head, and there is nothing called wiping over the neck. As for the raising of hands in Salat, it is a sunnah, therefore if missed, the prayer is still valid. And then he mentions that there are three additional points where raising the hands is done, and that is before you go into the ruku'ah, and after you get back from the ruku'ah, and when you stand up after you do your first tashahud to start the third rak'ah. And then he goes, please correct me if I am wrong. Now, briefly, and I don't want to make this into a long answer, I will mention something about the evidences for wiping over the neck, and then we'll go through the wudu and the raising of the hands as quick as I can. The Hanafi school of thought and some of the Shafi'i school of thought are the ones supporting and classifying the wiping over the neck as an act of sunnah. Their evidences are that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam masaha ra'sahu biyadayhi, he wiped his head with his both hands, fa'aqbala bihima, he went from the front to the back, wa adbara bada'a bimuqaddam ar-ra's, so he started from the beginning of the head, then he went all the way ila qafah. The qafa is the very back of the neck. ثُمَّ رَدَّهُمَا, then he brought back his hands to where he started from. Now, this hadith here is reported in At-Tirmidhi. Al-Imam At-Tirmidhi alayhi rahmatullah said that this hadith of Abdullah ibn Zayd, the narrator of the hadith, he said, is the most valid thing in this topic, is this matter about wiping the neck, and the best. And then he says, and this is the view of a Shafi'i, Ahmed and Ishaq ibn Rahaway. Ahmed ibn Hanbal in his Musnad also has a hadith about wiping over the neck, and Al-Shafi'i also, and Ishaq ibn Rahaway, a great scholar of hadith and fiqh. In Muslim as well, in Sahih Muslim, and also this hadith is in Al-Bukhari, subhanAllah. And then they said, وَزَادَ بَعْدَ قَوْلِي فَأَقْبَلَ بِهِمَا وَأَدْبَرَ بَدَأَ بِمُقَدَّمِ رَأْسِهِ. Then they explained again as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wiped from the beginning of the head to the back of the neck, and then he brought them back to the beginning of the head. And this hadith, as I said, is in Muslim. The problem here, my dear sisters and my brothers, is where the scholars understand the back of the head, and it goes to the lower part of the neck. So here, this hadith is reported in Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, Ahmed ibn Hanbal, pretty much in almost every major book of hadith, that they have evidence that Rasulullah ﷺ wiped over his head from the beginning until the end to the nape, that is the bottom of the neck, and then he went back. But always remember one thing, the school of thoughts, the four of them, that is Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, Malik, Al-Shafi'i, are people that came before any hadith was compiled. They didn't know of any Bukhari, Muslim. All the books of hadith were compiled after these scholars have died, and Al-Shafi'i is the last of the three, and he was he died when Al-Bukhari was about 10 years of age. So all the school of thoughts, what they built their argument upon was that they built it on their own understanding when they heard people at their own time. In our days today, we see a lot of people wiping over their head. We cannot call that as bid'ah. And we cannot start hating people for doing that, or call them innovators, or as some people decide that because they are, in their view, doing an innovation, they are part of hellfire. All these are extremist, hate-mongering people. These people understood, and believe me, when you go into the books of fiqh, you will find a boxing ring between scholars as to whether wiping over the neck is an act of sunnah or not. Obviously, as I said, before the advent of the coming of Bukhari, Muslim, and the books of Hadith, people before that did wipe over the neck and it was okay. It's only later when they compiled and collected the Hadith that some scholars found out that it is not part and it will stay with us until the end of time. So when you see someone wiping over the neck, just understand that they have some evidences which they understood or their scholars understood that wiping over the neck is part of their belief and leave it at that. You don't do it, alhamdulillah, that's what you believe. Because in the day of Al-Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask you as to why you did what you did based on what choice. And He will ask you, He will not tell you why other people. So the person wipes over the neck on the day of Al-Qiyamah, they will stand in front of Allah and Allah will ask them, and it is none of your business, none of my business, to become judgmental. We must stop this being judgmental, and that we are the true, correct ones, as the Salafi think of themselves, like they are the guardians of the galaxy or guardians of Islam, that what they do is the absolute truth and what the other people do is bid'ah, and the bid'ah is going to hellfire. That is absolutely very judgmental, very wrong to think that way. As I said, this hadith exists, and the scholars differ and disagree about what they mean. Qafah, in Arabic, the term qafah, al-qafah is the neck of a person. And in the books of fiqh, in the hadith, especially the Salafi, they say, no, the qafah is the back of the head. But no, the qafah is the neck of a person, the back of the neck of a person, and the disagreement comes here. So, you don't want to do it, don't do it. You want to do it, do it, but you have your own evidence and leave it to Allah like that. This brings me to speak about the wudu. Always pay attention that al-wudu is an ayah, the surah in the Quran. The ayah about al-wudu exists in surah al-ma'idah. Al-ma'idah is amongst the very, very last surah that were revealed in al-Quran at the end of Rasulullah's life. After al-ma'idah was revealed surah al-tawbah, to speak about the hypocrites. But al-ma'idah is the last of what has been revealed. And what's in al-ma'idah is really the predominant of what Allah wants from us. Surah Al-Ma'idah, that is surah number 5, in the ayah number 6, the ayah is a few lines, about 6 lines, that's all there is to it, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala easily and simply tells us how to perform wudu. And in this very example, you will see how Allah makes it very simple and easy for us to make wudu, and how the books of fiqh, argument of scholars, complicate something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made simple. The complications of these scholars have created amongst us a lot of people that have the waswas about the wudu. If people performed wudu as Allah mentioned it in Al-Quran, there will be nobody that will suffer from the waswas. Allah says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, you men and women who have believed in the Islam brought by the Messenger. إِذَا قُمْتُمْ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ, when you stand up for prayer. What this means is, if you weren't already in a state of wudu and you are aiming to perform salat, then at that moment there, فَغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ, wash your faces. What I am going to mention here, my sisters and my brothers, is the wudu. You perform it, your salat is 100% valid. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the first thing you do, wash your faces. You see, in our wudu, we start always with our hands. That is an addition by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because people before work in field, pick up dust, pick up dirt. So before putting their hands in whatever part they're going to use to make their wudu, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam started by washing the hands to clear and clean the hands, so that when he picks up the water to perform the real wudu of that is mentioned in the Quran, his hands are not dirty. That's all there is to it. If you don't want to wash your hands at the beginning of the wudu, don't. It's not the end of the world. Just ensure that your hands are clean enough as not to dirty the water that you're going to perform your wudu with. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَغْسِلُوا وُجُوهَكُمْ, then so you wash your faces, وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ, and your hands up to the elbows. A huge percentage of Muslims fail to implement this compulsory pillar of the wudu. and that is to wash the hands first and then all the way up to the elbows in one go. So after you have finished washing your face, what you do is you take water, you wash your hand first, and then go all the way to the elbows. People these days, because they washed their hand at the beginning of the wudu, they think that the hands on the second ayah, which is this one here, to wash the hands up to the elbows, the hands are not part of that act of washing the forearm. In fact, it's a huge mistake. So what you should do is, after you have finished washing your face, take water, wash your hand, the right hand first, and then go all the way to the elbow. Do that three times. Every time you start with the hand, and then you travel up to your elbow. And then you do that to the left as well. You start with the hand, and you go all the way up to the elbow. Once that is done, وَامْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ, and wipe your heads. Now, what's required here is to wipe the head, not the hair. The hair is part of the head. That's why we wipe over the head. But let's say you are wearing a turban, or the ladies wear the khimar or something like that. When you wipe over what you are wearing over your head, that's considered as you have wiped over the head. I forgot to say, when Allah says, wash your faces, when Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam washed the inside of his mouth and his nose, because they are part of the face. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't bring anything new. He just showed us that the nose and the mouth, the internal part of the mouth, in your tongue and things like that, are part of your face. Anyhow. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as I said, says, and wipe your head. وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ. Once you have wiped your head, it doesn't matter how you do it. You go from the front to the back, you back to the right, from right to left, left to right. If you take, even you take little water and you just wipe the beginning of the head, if you have a hairstyle, you don't want to mess around, you just touch the beginning of the head, all these are valid. You don't have to go from the beginning to the back or back front. People, they say from the beginning to the end of the head, that is the fard, that is what you must do, and the beginning is sunnah. That's actually a false statement. If you take a little water and you just put three fingers on your head and you move them slightly to the right, to the left, front, back, whatever you want to do, that is wiping off the head, and that is more than enough. You see the simplicity of how the Quran says, wash your face, and then the hands up to the elbows, and a little bit of your head. And if Allah says, وَامْسَحُوا رُؤُوسَكُمْ, if there was not the B of, if Allah says, وَامْسَحُوا رُؤُوسَكُمْ, then He would have said, and wipe over your complete head. But because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says B, that term B means partial of your head. How beautiful this is. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ إِلَى الْكَعْبَيْنِ, and your feet to the ankle. There has always been an argument between Muslims as to whether the feet must be wiped over or washed. And the confusion comes from the fact that Allah mentioned the feet right after He mentioned the wiping over the head. Because as Allah says, wipe, you don't take in water, you just wipe with your hand, and then He straightway says, وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ, and your feet. So they said, because Allah says, you wipe over the head, so we also must wipe over the feet. And this is what the Muslim Shia do, and that is they wipe over their feet, they don't wash them. You might be surprised, really, really surprised to say or to hear that this statement was at one point in our lives held by Ali ibn Abi Talib, Abdullah ibn Abbas, and Anas. And then they say, as it is reported in Fath al-Bari by Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani in his volume 1, page 320, that these Sahaba, these people that were with Rasulullah, the companions, have retracted their argument later on, and they want for the washing. But this created a huge confusion. What made Ali, who grew up with Rasulullah from the year 6 until he was murdered in his 60s, radiallahu anhu, he was murdered. What made him say that wiping over the feet is valid argument? And Abdullah ibn Abbas, Habar al-Ummah, he's like the ocean of knowledge of these Muslims. And Anas, a kid who served Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for 10 years. What made them say that the feet can be wiped over and not washed? And then they say they retract. It's like thus, these companions, they say an argument and then they say, you know what, I retract this. These people, it's not like they have lived all their lives away from Rasulullah. They only heard and they said something, they made a mistake. These people lived with Rasulullah. Ali, who doesn't know Ali, the husband of Fatima. Abdullah ibn Abbas, a member. Al-Abbas is the uncle of Rasulullah. Abdullah is a cousin of Rasulullah. And Anas lives with Rasulullah. This makes you wonder sometimes what our scholars are up to. But in any way, there is a consensus and agreement between all those that saw Rasulullah and our scholars that we Arjulakum here goes back all the way when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says wa aydiyakum ila al-marafiq. And the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala delays the mention of the feet is because he mentioned what should be done in sequence. The very first thing is the washing of the face, then the hands up to the elbows, then we wipe over the head, and then the feet. If Allah had put the feet right after the hands, then the wudu would have been like this. We wash the face, then the hands up to the elbows, then we would have washed the feet and did our head. But Allah doesn't want that. Allah wants the face first, the hands to the elbows second, we wipe over part of our head third, and then we do our feet. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put arjulakum after aydiyakum, so that he says, and at the end of the wudu, wash over your feet. And then Allah, simple wudu, four parts of it. In the books of fiqh, they say, if you don't say Bismillah, your wudu is void. Who says that? They say a hadith, and then they went and mess up all the easiness of al-Islam. Because Allah says, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ جُنُوبًا فَاتَّهَارُوا. If you are in a state of janaba, i.e. had a sexual discharge, purify yourself, i.e. bathe your whole body. Allah didn't go into details as to how you wash your body. Neither did Rasulullah, because Islam is beautifully and simple. But the books of hadith and the argument of scholars and different versions of the hadith and this, they complicate the washing of the body. You must start with the right top and then you go to the left and the left, and it becomes a complicated issue. And the poor Muslims, they get into the shower and then they get confused. Did I do my right properly? Did I do my left properly? Did I do this properly? Did I do that properly? When Allah says to you, when you get into a shower, just take your shower regularly, normally, and that is ghusl. You don't need to do anything different than taking a shower. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us something that is even more beautiful. He goes, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ جُنُوبًا فَاتَّهَرُوا. And if you are in a state of janaba, or had a sexual discharge, purify yourself, i.e. wash your body. But there are exceptions. Sometimes, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ مَرْضًا. And there are situations, and he says, if you were ill, أو على سفرٍ, or you were on a journey, أو جاء أحد منكم من الغائط, or if one of you has come from relieving themselves from either the bathroom or outside in the mountains, أو لامستم النساء, or had intimate contact with your spouses, فلم تجدوا ماء, and the situation is that you find no water. Either you are sick and you can't use water, or you are on a trip and you don't have water, or you have been to the toilet and you are short of water, you don't have water, or you had an intimate relationship with your spouse and there is no water. What do we do, Ya Allah? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَتَيَمَّمُوا. At-tayammum in Arabic is to head towards something good. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then have recourse to end use. And the verb recourse means the use of someone or something as a source of help in a difficult situation. And then what do we, Ya Allah, now you have given us a bigger option, a beautiful option, and that is we recourse to something. What is that something? He gets sa'idan, that is the dust tayyib, a beautiful tayyib sa'id. When you go into the, Allah says any dust will do. Any dust. He didn't say anything. He says any dust. In the books of fiqh, they go into some chapters upon chapters until you get a headache and you get, at the end of it, confused. Even some places, they take a rock, like a very soft rock, and that is to them is dust, when in fact it is not. Because Allah sa'idan means land dust. What do we do with that, Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to purify ourselves? Allah says, فَمْسَحُوا بِوُجُوهِكُمْ. Wipe your faces, وَأَيْدِيكُمْ مِنْهُ. enhance with it. Beauty sample. Rasulullah showed us how we do it. You go to the land and you go with your hands, both hands like this, one time, and you wipe gently over your face, and you take another one and you do your hands. And some scholars, they say just with one tap, you do your face and your hands. Ya Allah, how beautiful. Then Allah establishes a beautiful rule, and that rule is مَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيَجْعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. Allah does not wish to place any burden or hardships upon you. This is why He made the wudu so simple. وَلَكِنْ يُرِيدُ لِيُطَهِرَكُمْ. Or rather, He wants to purify you. وَلْيُتِمَّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكُمْ. And that He completes His favors upon you. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. So that you be grateful and thankful. And as I said, this is in Surah Al-Ma'idah, the big table. And that is number 5th surah in Al-Quran. And the ayah is number 6. 6 lines in Al-Quran, beautifully explained by Allah. In the books of fiqh, hundreds upon hundreds of ahadith that complicate the whole situation of al-wudu. So much so that we have lots of Muslims that have fallen sick to the whispers of shaitan, and they start counting 1, 2, 3, and they get so confused so much. And that is because, and that is the price of putting the Quran behind our backs. So this is in 2 words about the wudu. When it comes to the, so if you see someone, again to recap, if you see someone wiping over their neck, say they have understood, not misunderstood, they understood the text of a hadith different than what you do, and leave it as that. Don't go to him and you say the sunnah, because as soon as you say the sunnah, especially in wudu, it's not compulsory, it does not affect at all the salat. But what is more serious is that you go break the heart of a Muslim over wiping over the neck, like the Saudis and the Wahhabi Salafi do, like you have to do exactly on their stereotype of how a Muslim should be. If you don't follow them, that's it. You are not a Muslim according to them. Wal'iyadu billah. What a huge wrong mistake they do. When it comes to raising of the hands of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the salat and how to do it, okay? In Tuhfat al-Ahwadi by al-Mubarak 41, he explained in Sunan al-Tirmidhi. He said, the companions of Rasul, and the translation is from me, he goes, those who were with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the companions, never agreed unanimously on one thing other than raising the hands of the salat. All of them have agreed about raising the hands in a salat, at the beginning of the salat, before you go into ruku' and after you raise from the ruku'. So all the companions did that. But always remember, so you say, how Abu Hanifa didn't know about that? Well, because Abu Hanifa is a man who grew up in Iraq, and the hadith were not collected in his time. So he used what he had at his time. It's later on. Always remember, it's about 300 years later after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that they compiled and collected the hadith. It's just like the Christians, you see. The Christians, they wrote the Bibles 300 years after Isa alayhi salam. We always blame the Christians and we tell them, you know what, you don't have the original Bible. Your Bible was written 300 years later. How can you trust that, blah, 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 right? But we Muslims do exactly the same thing. We don't have the original copy of Al-Bukhari, Muslim and Abu Dawud and all these things. We don't have the original copies. We wrote our hadith 300 years later and we do exactly what they did. But in any way. But when it comes to the raising of the hands, the hadith is an al-Bukhari Muslim. It's in every major book of hadith. Well, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, I take just one hadith. When he says, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا قام للصلاة, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, whenever he stood up for a salat, he used to raise his hands opposite the shoulder. كان صلى الله عليه وسلم رفع يديه حتى تكون حذو منكبيه. المنكب هنا is the shoulders. This is why the Muslims misunderstand this hadith or understand this hadith in a variety of forms. The Hanafi, they take it all the hands to the back of their ears. The Salafis, they take it like it's 2 signs of stop, like widely to the... As scholars say, if you raise your hands, you don't even raise them to the shoulder, that is enough. As a matter of fact, Raising the hands is nothing but an extra act of sunnah. It does nothing, absolutely nothing to your salat. Let me tell you something. Some people, they say when you raise your hands, you get extra rewards. But that is only if all the other parts of the salat have been done beautifully. Because if someone raises the hands and doesn't think, or is not with the Quran, or doesn't do the ruku' properly, or is not, his heart is not in the salat, it doesn't matter how many thousands of times you raise your hands, your reward will be far less than someone who doesn't raise their hands at all. Even when you say Allahu Akbar, if you don't raise your hands at that moment there, it doesn't hurt your salat a bit. I will repeat, when you say Allahu Akbar, if you don't raise your hands when you say Allahu Akbar, it does not hurt your salat a bit. What is important is what goes inside the salat and also what goes outside the salat, because it doesn't make the sense that some Muslims in their salat, they pray the salat and they say Ala la'natullah ala al-kathibin, may the curse of Allah be on the liars. And then as soon as they say Salaamu Alaikum, Salaamu Alaikum, they go and lie. It doesn't work like that. So in their salat, they curse the liars. Out of the salat, they are liars. It doesn't matter how many times they raise their hands, it will not affect positively their salat. It's how you feel, how you be, how you are in your salat. So if you see someone raising their hands, it's okay, that's what they're doing. Allah will ask them about why they did it and their evidence. If you don't want to raise your hands, don't do it at all. There are times for myself when I'm doing my salat, sometimes I just feel like I'm tired, I don't even want to move a finger. I enter my salat and it's a beautiful act that I say Allahu Akbar without raising the hands. It will seem odd and very strange to you that you do that, but you know what? You are not doing anything wrong. When you raise your hands, I'm adding extra value to my salat because I'm following a sunnah. But following a sunnah is not compulsory on you. It's a choice. It's something that you do from your heart. The Salafi make it like, what? You don't follow the sunnah? You don't? No. The sunnah, if Allah wanted us to follow the sunnah, He would have ordered us and made it a compulsory act. If Allah made it a choice, guess what? It stays a choice. And throughout the 1400 years, the Muslims have been in deafening battles. They have killed, insulted, hated each other just because someone sees something as a sunnah and the other one doesn't see it as a sunnah. And our history is really witnessing because of that and witnesses that until our times today. So to keep the whole situation simple, whatever you do is good. Because somewhere something has happened, you just need you to go and seek the information and do what you feel in your heart is the right thing to do. Don't do something just because people do it, and don't do something just because people don't do it. Do something after you have settled your heart that that is the truth. Do it because on the day of judgment, Allah will ask you about what you did, why you did it, where you got it from, and Allah knows what's in your heart. A lot of people keep their beards long because guess what? Because if they touch them, people will say, ha, and they keep the beards. And in their heart, that's why. It's because they want to appear they belong to some groups and things like that. It's not a motivation from the depth of themselves. It is more of an act of what people say. And there is hypocrisy. There is a lot of things. I pray to Allah to help us all be the best Muslims of what we choose based on what has reached us, and act on that and not be judgmental against each other, not be a classifying people, oh, this is right, this is bad. We do what we believe is good and we keep away from what we believe is wrong. And if someone else has a different understanding than ours, then we must be encompassing and we must be encouraging. As long as they are not doing something haram, everyone is doing great. I pray to Allah that this is an answer to the question, and I pray to Allah to bless us, to bless you and bless us all. Wa sallallahu nabiyyina Muhammad. If you want to join my group, please do send me a message on WhatsApp on 0787640 8735. This is again your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.